Welcome to Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. I'm your host, Kim Todd. On Digging Deeper, we have in-depth discussions with extension and industry experts about important landscape topics. Tonight, we're going to be focusing on plants for those rain gardens. Thank you for joining us once again for Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. You know, a few weeks ago, we talked about the importance of rain gardens. We're going to take some time to follow up on that tonight and talk about the plants that thrive in those environments. Joining me, I have Justin Evertson from the Nebraska Forest Service and Nebraska Statewide Arboretum.
Yep.
Justin, we go back a long ways.
Yep, long time.
And we can talk plants for way more than the amount of time we have. And I know that one of the things that you really concentrate your life on is making sure that communities get the absolute best product they can get in terms of landscape, what grows, what thrives, what doesn't. And a part of that is you come to us from almost Colorado.
Way out west.
Way out west.
Wyoming border, Kimball County.
So we bring the west to the east on occasion in your expertise, and you don't necessarily have a lot of the grain garden plants native out there,
no.
But probably some.
Yeah.
So talk about rain garden plants. What do you like? What don't you like?
Yeah.
What are you going to recommend to people?
Well, what I brought tonight, and we'll show some plants here in a little while, is mostly woody plants, because we don't think of woody plants for rain gardens all the time, but they do have a spot in there, so we'll get to that. And you mentioned Kimball County. Yeah, it's kind of an oxymoron. Do we really have rain gardens where it doesn't rain? But they still make sense. And one of my favorite rain gardens is out at the NRD in Sydney.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's dry country. And they capture all their rainwater from their roof, channel it through this rain garden. And it is really a wonderful experience. And so rain gardens, I always think, you know, we get three advantages from rain gardens. We get to slow and capture water. Save water, so that's a good thing. We get to beautify a landscape however we want to do that. And then we get to do all this wonderful stuff for pollinators and wildlife if you do it right and you blend the right plants together. So,
so
to me, it's a win-win-win.
Absolutely. So what are some of the plants that are in the Sydney Rain Garden?
Ooh, I'd have to go back and think about it. It's going to be more, you'd be surprised, things that we in the east that are kind of just typical garden plants
mm-hmm.
become more of a rain garden plant out there. So even something like salvia or some of the yarrows, things like that, because the rain is much more intermittent, it doesn't stay quite as wet.
Mm-hmm.
But they will do a few of the same things we can do here with rushes and sedges. And I brought a whole list of things, so goldenrods, purple coneflower, things we maybe take more for granted here in a traditional sense are better in a rain garden out there.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, one of the things that people think about in terms of the design is, do you use two or three species in a big sweep and a mass, or do you like a scatter approach in terms of choosing those plants? Because, of course, as a plant person, there's no such thing as too many of any one thing.
Yeah, how do you figure that out? I mean, you're a better designer than I am.
I'm more of a scattergun approach person, but I know there are situations where, you know, a beautiful big band of a single plant makes a lot of sense.
That's not my style, and I always tell people when they ask me, like, if they want my help, I'm always tempted to say, are you sure you want my help? Because I'm really relaxed. And I really like the natural look of things, and I really like the idea of pollinators and insects and birds. So I'm pretty wild. I even let a few weeds go. That's my personal style. I don't mm-hmm. force that on anybody else, but that's me. And mm-hmm. so somebody else maybe wants a landscape more refined or more traditional, then I'm going to say, how much time are you going to give it? Because mm-hmm. if you're after an extension of your garden, your refined flower garden, it's going to take some work. One thing we've learned over the years is rain gardens are real attractive to weeds, especially here in the east, and it's the tall weeds, especially woody plants and stuff. So
mm-hmm.
just be careful about how much time you can give it before you figure out your goals of what you want that rain garden to do. Well, a simple solution, most people don't want to do this, but if you don't have a lot of time, you could put something together like prairie cordgrass
mm-hmm.
and palm sedge and maybe one or two wildflowers. Just let them duke it out. maybe mow it every so often. That's a real low maintenance rain garden, but probably not the look that most people want. So what's your cup of tea?
Well, and that's a really good point, because I do know that in our, I think now 4-year-old rain chain on East Campus, it was a very good mix, you know, working with Arboretum, et cetera. And there are some garden plants in there now, or some sedges in particular, that's like, oh my goodness, are they happy in that
took
rain
over.
Garden?
Yeah.
Took over,
and
really.
Is that good?
I think we're going to kind of rein some of them back a little ways, so that we have a little bit more of that quality and character of the all-season interest.
Well, I love a garden where it has those splashes of colors and textures like you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a little more work to maintain it over time, so I hardly ever achieve it. But I love to go see them when other people are maintaining them.
Right, exactly.
And that rain chain you developed, that's one of the best ones I can remember seeing for that kind of style.
Well, it's interesting, too, to see that the Liatris has seeded itself just absolutely beautifully. And that one we're probably going to let go wherever.
Yes.
So let's talk about some of the things
you
brought.
Yeah, I didn't get too many perennials in here. Do we want to put them closer, or what do we want to do here? I don't want to block myself.
Yeah, that's
we can do
perfect.
This.
Perfect. Yeah.
So maybe pull one out right here. And I wasn't sure what this is. We put it in our Wayne Park bioretention swell a few years ago, and now it's spread all over. So it's an iris, and I'm not exactly sure what kind. You know, is that the Siberian iris?
It looks like a Siberian, a white variety of it, probably.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's been real happy. So I've only got a few perennials to show you, but that was an iris.
You know, that one too, Justin, we have the one that's called Fontanelle in our rain garden, and then the Siberians, and I know some people will try the Japanese iris. They're a little touchier.
Yeah.
But, I mean, they give you that beautiful color.
And we can talk about, there's more of them, right? There's like the blue flag iris, which is a North American native.
Right.
I don't have it in this garden. I would love to get it. And then there's the yellow flag, which is a non-native. They're worried about invading waterways, but I think it's still okay in a, or no?
It's invasive.
Okay, that so one leave is. It off the,
yeah.
I'm glad
but
you
there
said
is a
that.
Yellow Siberian, if
okay.
people want the yellow.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, good choices.
So, speaking of yellow.
Yeah. I don't know if you can see this very well. It's a light yellow, Golden Alexander's, the Zizia. And this is one of those wild ones that you were just talking about. I let it do its thing, but it's a little wild. I really love it in my wet shade gardens where it pops up here and there, but it gets a little bit above the other plants. And so sometimes I wonder if maybe people think it looks a little weedy. I just don't listen to it.
Blooms really early, though.
Yeah.
Usually, I mean, you get a lot of early bloom on it. So that's one of the advantages, I think, that you would agree with me on that. If you have all that different mix, you start flowering early, you have fall color or additional flowering.
Love
late.
That it's early nature.
Right.
And it outcompetes weeds early in the season.
Right.
So where we have this in Waverly, it's in a park in Wayne Park. I've used it for running around in the shade under trees and out competing the weeds, and then it's moved into wetter areas, so I've loved it.
Perfect. Yeah.
One more perennial to show you, and that's just a spider wart. I was hoping you could identify it for me. I'm not sure if it's the Ohio spider wart or what, but it's moving around in our wet meadow out in the park really aggressively, and so I'm happy with it. I let it go, and the blooms aren't out right now, but maybe tomorrow it would have been blooming its tail off.
Well, and they last one day, so you might have had one today.
Yeah, right. So,
I do know that people in a managed landscape who have spiderwort that was a gift from another gardener or a bird will think, "My goodness, this one really does want to keep its territory." But it certainly works in a rain garden situation.
Yep. I love plants that move around and show up where they weren't intended, but I know that that's not most people, so.
Exactly.
And maybe we'll touch here quickly just on a few shrubs and trees, actually. So what do we got in the potpourri of plants here? Here's an interesting one. This you might recognize. I think these are the female flowers. This is black gum.
Oh, boy.
And we don't think of rain gardens for trees and shrubs because trees and shrubs take up so much space. But if you have the room, and in a park like we're talking about here, we have plenty of room. So we've put black gum and other trees right at the edge of the rain garden. And in the fall, when this turns that brilliant kind of orange purple, that's when you know you have a winner of a tree, and it gets these aren't they like a trilobed seed pod coming on here later in the season too. So really good for wet areas. That's black gum.
You know, I'm glad you brought that one up. We have not many on campus, but it is probably one of those underutilized trees. We're getting some questions about
good.
Now. I wonder how far west it would go.
Yeah, unfortunately, I would guess this is an eastern half of Nebraska tree, and it wants consistent moisture. It's not, like I say, it's not the first crayon out of the toolbox in your new landscape, but where you have a little protection. Right. You might know it better than I do. I think it's tougher than we give it credit for.
I think it is too. Yeah, I think you have to be careful with source, which is really one of the things we would say anyway about most plants. There's some interesting cultivars on the market that we haven't tried with names like Fire Starter.
Oh, wow.
Which suggests really red in the fall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so black gum, we better get rolling on this. This is one that's not, this would work across the state and really in any wet area or even a marginally, seasonally wet area. Laurel willow.
Oh boy.
Laurel willow. I love its really dark green upper leaf and lighter underside of the leaf. And right now they're spitting their cotton out. So it looks like cottonwood cotton coming out right now in the park. So some people might not like that. But if you've got a wet spot where you'd like a willow, and then not a weeping willow, but one with really dark foliage, I'd go for a laurel willow.
Yeah, you know that, and it's got a nice uniform,
very nice
character to it. So for people who don't want quite that wild and crazy, beautiful glossy foliage, that's a great thought.
Now here's one we should talk about.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah, this is button bush, and it's just now starting to push out. It's button-like flower heads that will be blooming, what do you think, in about a month or so?
Yeah, or maybe even a little, middle summer usually.
Yeah.
They're
one of the last things to bloom from the spring period. But boy, when they bloom, the bees just go for it. It's one of the best pollinator plants out there.
Well, and every single one of those is about an inch in diameter. And sweetly scented for people.
Right.
Not just the pollinators. They're big.
Yeah, they get big.
The straight species gets big, I know. And then there are ones on the market that have names like Sputnik.
And
Sugar Shack.
Yeah. It's supposed to be about half the size.
We'll see. You know, they don't read the book. You know, again, Justin, you mentioned earlier that some of these are a lot tougher than we give them credit for. Is buttonbush one of those in your estimation?
That's one I've figured out. It's amazingly drought tolerant once you have it established.
A little bit of dieback maybe in the winter sometimes.
Some years.
But most plants do. Yeah.
And like you said, be aware it'll be a small tree eventually if you let it go that way.
Right. Not much seems to bother it.
No.
In terms of, you know, the insects that bother it are the ones we want to bother.
Right. I love it for a big park area, so that's what we're working with here. In a yard you probably have room for one. If that's. And then one more plant to think about here that I just pulled out of our little wetland in Waverly. This is silky dogwood, Cornus amomum, I think it is. And this is one that does prefer more moisture. We have our gray dogwood and then our rough leaf dogwood that you could plant in the worst sites in the world and they'll thrive.
Right.
But this is silky dogwood. I'm sure it's tougher than I give it credit for, but it does like it wet. And you get this nice spring white flower, late summer, fall, dark black berries, white to black berries, and then in the fall you get nice red fall color. So beware that this one wants to sucker around a little bit on you, but give it room.
So again, if we use plants that will behave themselves a bit, I mean, a black gum is not going to form a colony.
Right.
And then you've got the other ones that are the colonizers, and you do a little bit of mixing in with perennials. Talk a little bit about the ground cover. Is it sedges?
Oh, I love sedges for ground cover for sure. And there's so many of them. I don't keep up with all the ones on the market. I'm trying to think. There's bristle leaf sedge. I mentioned palm sedge earlier. It's a tall one, so if you have room for tall ones. I really like the little Pennsylvania sedge for the smaller spaces. You probably know some of the species a little better than I do. Fox sedge, gray sedge, there's probably two dozen sedges, and you can let them run around and duke it out.
Yep. I know that one of the perennials that we have blooming right now is bee balm.
Oh, I love it.
And there are multiples of that. And of course, then we get people saying, okay, powdery mildew, but it looks to me like the ones that we've chosen for the rain gardens don't get powdery
mildew.
I've
been impressed. I don't know all the cultivar names, but in recent years, the ones I've watched, wow, the ones I put in my yard, they're mildew-free. So.
And then we have, of course, the milkweeds.
Yes.
So any favorites in the milkweeds or?
Yeah, I'm kind of okay with wildness. And in our park, people are frustrated because I let the common milkweed go, and it can be really wild. But that swamp milkweed is a wonderful one to put in any kind of a rain garden. And, you know, it'll get 3 to 4 feet tall. But and it's not the only one. There are other milkweeds. There's purple milkweed, greenhorn milkweed. But
we have one great big Rudbeckia in our rain garden, which is our native golden glow. And
golden glow.
When that one is in flower, you're a pretty tall guy, but I think Herbstone is the name of the one we've got.
I know
what
you're talking about. That's a native originally, a woodland edge plant?
Big bushel basket full of flowers.
Yes, I've never messed with it, but it's a tall one, yeah.
Tall. And, you know, and self-cleaning. So, and what that means for our viewers is you don't have to go in there and clip and deadhead like you do with roses or something like that to keep it in flower. So, if people really want to explore the rain garden plants, any suggestions for how to start or where to look or, are things labeled in your rain garden in Waverly example?
I would have said, come to the backyard farmer garden and the rain chain, and is that open to the public right now? Okay, the best one I've seen for things being labeled and or at least some of it being labeled.
Right.
That's a really good one. If you want to go out to eat and then see a rain garden, go out to Fireworks Restaurant in Southeast Lincoln. I shouldn't be plugging for them, but there's a rain garden right behind that. None of the plants are labeled, but you'll get a sense of what it can do in kind of a wild sense.
Right.
And come on out to Waverly. I'll show you just go to Wayne Park and poke around our wet meadow, and you'll see some of this going on there.
And I think one of the fun times to see plants in a rain garden is in the rain.
Oh, man.
I mean, you can see what will lie down and what will stand up and what's going to be able to accomplish what
Imagine
you want with
that,
it.
Imagine that, being out in the rain garden in the rain.
You know, put on your little boots and out you go into the rain garden. All right. Well, that's almost all the time we have, Justin, for digging deeper. Are there any plants that people really should stay away from that you can think of?
Well, that's a really good point. I think we mentioned like yellow flag iris, which used to be really commonly recommended for rain gardens, and now it's on the invasive watch list, so I sure wouldn't do that. And that's a good place to start. Go to that invasive plants list for Nebraska. I don't remember the URL, but start there, and it'll show several perennial or herbaceous species that are on the threatened or coming on stage that you should steer clear of, and many of them like wet areas. So
exactly, right. We want to make sure you watch us on Facebook, and then, of course, give us your comments, tell us whether you like what we're talking about, give us suggestions, ask us additional questions, because, of course, we can answer them, our experts can answer them, Backyard Farmer can answer them. We want to make sure that if you're choosing the plants that are fabulous for those wetter rain garden conditions, the pollinators, making your landscape look the way you want it to, that we've given you all that really good advice. So Justin, thanks for coming tonight. Really appreciate your expertise as always. It's always fun to have you around.
Thanks for having
me. Even though I didn't bring you any donuts, which is a personal favorite.
Somebody said donuts, oh well.
And that is all the time we have for Digging Deeper with Backyard Farmer. I do want to say thanks to Justin again. We'll be back next week with another discussion about those gardening topics that matter to you. Do be sure to watch Backyard Farmer Live every Thursday at 7 p.m. Central on NET and at 10 a.m. on Saturdays. Thanks for digging deeper with Backyard Farmer.